Hello and welcome. In this video, I'm going to break down the color grade on one shot from my most popular iPhone film that I shot in Dubai Marina. I'm not going to show you how to use Resolve right now, as it's beyond the scope of one introductory video. What I want to do is cover the method and process, and also the why and how of color correction. If you like what I'm going to show you, I encourage you to subscribe to my channel. If you're looking for shortcuts though, you might be disappointed. The most important thing you can do if you want to follow along and practice is to download DaVinci Resolve from the Blackmagic Design website. You'll find the link to the Resolve support page where you can find the free download in the details section below the video. There are two versions of DaVinci Resolve: DaVinci Resolve Studio, which requires a licensed dongle, and DaVinci Resolve. DaVinci Resolve is completely free, and that's the version you want. One thing you need to keep in mind is that the system requirements for Resolve are pretty heavy. You'll need a fast workstation or a newer laptop with a fast processor, lots of memory, and most importantly, a good GPU. Most of today's gaming GPUs would work just fine, as long as you have at least 2 gigs of video memory. You'll need fast storage for your media too. An SSD drive is ideal for the kind of work and type of media I'm going to show you. I'm going to keep this simple. There's a few objectives every colorist has. Correction of any technical inconsistencies in camera source media or mistakes made on set. Balancing and matching source media throughout the project. Consistency of color throughout the project. Even if the mood or style varies, those moods or styles must be consistent. And meeting all technical requirements for deliverables. There are always many ways to work, many routes to achieve the same result, but I'm going to show you a logical step-by-step workflow. DaVinci Resolve consists of 4 sections. The media page lets you organize and manage your media and bring it from your storage into your project media pool. The edit page is where you'll find all the editing tools, which will be familiar to any editor. The color page gives you all of your color tools. And finally, the delivery page is where you'll output your final project. I've opened the Dubai Marina project specifically to show you my color correction and grading method and introduce you to a few of the most common tools. You can see here the color page of DaVinci Resolve and the sequence of shots that make up my edited video. Each shot has a thumbnail, and when I click on a thumbnail, that shot is selected and becomes the shot I'm working on. Color correction is performed to each individual shot in the sequence. Corrections and grades can be copied from one shot to another using the stills gallery. At this point, it's important to introduce you to the node. Color correction and resolve takes place in a series or chain of distinct operations, one after the other, and these operations are separated into nodes like links in a chain. A node has an input and an output. The first node input is connected to the camera's source media, the uncorrected image, which is interpreted from the video file according to certain project settings. This first node is connected to a node tree output, which gives us the image that we see in our monitor window, and on a dedicated video monitor output to a calibrated precision display if we have one connected. There can be, and usually is, more than one node used to color correct a shot, and there are a few different types of nodes. To keep things simple, I will show you a shot that only makes use of serial nodes. A serial node is the simplest type of node, and these are connected end to end in a chain. It's worth mentioning that Resolve gives you both clip and timeline nodes. Clip nodes apply to the individual clip you are working on. A timeline node applies to the entire timeline and are applied after the clip nodes. In this example, I've used both clip nodes and timeline nodes. In my timeline node, I've applied a LUT. A LUT is a lookup table, and in a very simple sense, it's a preset image transform, which I've used in this case to imitate a specific type of print film stock. We'll revisit these nodes later. For now, I'll turn all my nodes off, or bypass them, so I can take you through them one by one. You bypass a node by clicking on the node number in the top left corner of the node. Let's take a look at one master shot from my example video. A master shot is what I call the one shot in a sequence that becomes the reference for matching all the other shots in the same sequence. It's usually a fairly wide shot, and I'll work on it first. Our first step is correction of any technical inconsistencies in the camera's source media, or mistakes that were made in camera. We will correct any issues and bring the shot to a well-balanced starting point, making sure that exposure is correct and both white and black are correctly balanced. If there's a human subject in the shot, we can also make sure skin tones are correct, but in this example there are no skin tones. The first thing I'm going to do is open my video scopes. The scopes are critical to this first step, because no matter what your monitor window is showing you, the scopes don't lie. They will give you an objective, correct view of your luminance or brightness values, and chroma or color values, and present them in a few useful ways. There are three particular scopes I rely on: the waveform, parade, and vector scope. They are crucial to understand if you really want to get into color. The waveform and parade scope plot your luminance levels in the image from the left side to the right side, and from 0 at the bottom to 100% at the top. The parade simply separates the RGB channels. Let's take a look at the node tree. I always leave one node untouched. This means I've got a clean, original camera source image to pull into other nodes if I want later. My second node is my primary balance. Below the node, you'll see some icons. These indicate the tools which have been used on that node. In this case, a simple balance using the primary controls was all that was necessary. The primary wheels are labeled lift, gamma, and gain. Lift affects the shadows, gamma affects the midtones, and gain affects the highlights of the image. I'm going to create a new version of this shot so I can show you without messing up my actual grade. You have control of the balance of hue or color affecting red, green, and blue channels separately, as well as the luminance or brightness of the shadows, midtones, and highlights. A primary balance consists of making sure the luminance levels of all the objects in the shot are where they should be relative to each other and the context of the scene. I refer to the Ansel Adams zone system as a reference for luminance levels. I'll temporarily drop the saturation to 0 just to see the luminance levels of various objects in the shot and make adjustments. Primary correction also involves making sure that the hue, or color, is correctly balanced. In most cases, white objects in the shot should appear white, and in the parade scope, that will be indicated when red, green, and blue components of the white objects are at the same level. Black should also be black. And a true black object will be indicated in the parade scope when red, green, and blue levels are equal and at or near 0. Quite often, when overall exposure, luminance levels, and white balance are corrected, the rest of the image will also be correct. Sometimes other corrections are necessary to bring the overall image into balance. Once you've got the shot corrected and balanced, it's time to get creative. The order I worked on this shot is not necessarily the only way to do it, but it is my approach and I find it works well. At this point, I want to revisit the timeline nodes. After my primary balance, I knew that I wanted to check out how one of Resolve's film emulation LUTs would look. Because this is an overall look that applies to the whole film, it goes on a timeline node, not a clip node. A LUT is created for a specific video standard to transform an input to a different output for technical or creative purposes. It expects a specific video input, and if the levels of the input are not exactly what it expects, the output may not be quite what you expect. In my case, this LUT is doing what I want it to do, but it's too strong, so I reduced the output key to 50% and then decided to keep it active while I made other adjustments to the clip nodes. Back to the clip node tree, and at this point it's a decent looking, well balanced image. I could have called this finished, but I want a more stylized look, specifically to bring out the pink tones in the sky. So the next node, which you can see is numbered 3, and is actually at the end only because you're seeing the finished node tree here, is my grade, or stylistic look. A creative look doesn't have to be true to life, but it shouldn't be too extreme. I simply used the color wheels again to push blues into the shadows, orange into the midtones, and a bit of red into the highlights. When you do this though, you need to be careful to keep the blacks balanced. Black needs to remain black, and to do this, I used a luminance versus saturation curve to bring saturation to zero only at both the lowest and highest luminance levels in the image. This will also make sure my brightest highlights remain white. I also applied a custom curve to add some more contrast. You can always enhance an image further by making specific local adjustments using power windows. These are called secondary corrections. Node 4 is a gradient isolating the sky area. You can click on the highlight tool to show only the area you are isolating with the mask. I've added a simple custom curve here to bring down the luminance of the sky and further add contrast to bring out the subtle wisps of cloud. This adds a bit more of a gradient to the sky. I decided the effect needed to be toned down slightly, so I reduced the node output key to 90%. Node 5, I decided to add some subtle sharpening. Node 6 is back to secondaries, and I decided to darken the water at the bottom of the frame. This was achieved with a gradient power window and a custom curve. Node 7 is a circular power window. To bring up the highlights of the reflection on the water and the white of the boats in the marina, it helps these highlights to pop and draws attention. Overall, the effect of these corrections and creative adjustments together brings the shot to a polished, finished place which makes a strong visual impact. You can see now the difference before and after all this work. This is just one shot in the sequence. The other shots need to match. When I talk about matching shots, the goal is to ensure that the same objects under the same lighting conditions within a sequence of shots all have the same luminance and the same hue. Right-clicking this shot in the viewer and choosing to grab still saves this grade, this whole node tree, into the gallery. Applying the exact same nodes with their adjustments to another shot is as simple as right-clicking on the gallery still and applying that grade to the new shot. However, it's rarely this simple. Each shot in a sequence has its own differences in light or levels, even if they were shot under the same conditions. I'll always perform a primary balance manually on every individual shot. That's where the shot matching actually happens, and this is where the scopes become critical. I won't dig any deeper in this video, but it's safe to say I've only scratched the surface. If this video has piqued your interest, then I hope you'll stick around. Please subscribe to the channel and let me know in the comments about your thoughts or any questions you have. Thanks for watching.